Hi, everyone. Welcome to our Berkeley Rep Zoom Talkback with Director Awoye Timpo. Hi, Awoye.
Hey, what's up, Nailah?
Nothing much, you know, just at my house, as we are.
To see you.
You too. Thank you so much for being here. I know it's a tough time for a lot of us, and so I just really appreciate you taking the time to connect with our audiences in this virtual space. So my name is Nailah, and I was the assistant director for the show, and I'm also the Berkeley Rep directing fellow. So excited to be here with you. So here's a bit of the rundown. How's this going to go? This conversation is going to last about 30 minutes, like a regular talkback would. We've solicited questions from audience members who have seen the recording, and I also brought some questions to the table as well. And we imagine that many of you have seen Schoolgirls, so we will be including spoilers. So Awoye, it's okay to give some... if you haven't, though, pause it and go watch it. Come right on back. We'll be here. So, without further ado, just pretend you're in your seats in the Rota Theater and the lights have come up after seeing the show, and Awoye is here with us on stage. Welcome.
Yay. Thank you so much. It's like, even though we can't be together in person, it feels good to be able to connect in another way, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So let me just start with what first drew you to this play and what does it mean to you?
Yeah, no, there's it's so many things, actually. I think the first thing that drew me to the play was actually Jocelyn herself. So I've known Jocelyn, I can't remember when we met, but we met at some point during both of our times here in New York, and she had been working on this play called Nollywood Dreams, which is this hilarious comedy that Jocelyn was writing about the Nollywood film industry. And so I had seen like a number of readings of that play, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is incredible. First of all, it was so funny. I feel like it's so hard for people to write. It's a real gift to be able to write comedy the way that Jocelyn writes comedy. She just has such an amazing ear and is so kind of perfect at crafting characters. So that's really when I first kind of encountered Jocelyn. And then it was actually years later that I got the chance to see Schoolgirls when it was down at MCC here in the city. And I was just kind of blown away. And, you know, above and beyond the kind of personal human connection just between Jocelyn, it was also that there was this incredible playwright writing stories about people from Ghana, which is where our parents are both from. And so it was kind of just this great thrill and opportunity to kind of tell the stories of our mothers, of our aunts. You know, my mother went to a boarding school very similar to Ebury. And I had heard so many stories about it over the years, and I've been there before. But just to be able to kind of articulate and share the story of all these girls was just really, really exciting.
Definitely. Thank you. And, you know, it's funny that you talked about the sort of personal connection. We had so many people virtually and in person come into our rehearsal room, and it was just such a gift to be able to have those personal connections literally in the work. And so I was hoping that you could maybe talk a little bit about what it's like for you to sort of, with the actors, build a world. And if you could tell us a little bit more about that process, because at least in this rehearsal process, we had tons of sort of a collective, collaborative dramaturgy. We had a lot of table work. We had people coming into the space. And is that something that you normally do in your directing process, or did you sort of tailor that to this show?
No, it's so much fun. You know, what I have come to do in the past couple of years is to kind of let everybody participate in the dramaturgical process, you know, because I think sometimes, you know, we get to rehearsal on the first day and you get this amazing, brilliant packet of dramaturgy that the dramaturgs have so diligently put together and spent so much time and energy kind of carving out all of these beautiful details about the world of the play. And it can be, it's a great resource. It's like a great encyclopedia for the world. But it's also very hard to consume it all over the course of the process. You know, it's like an embarrassment of riches. And so the thing that we did in this process and that I've been doing a bunch is having each of the actors kind of take one subject matter. So we assigned everybody, you know, a topic, and then and then everybody has to do like a presentation on the topic that they were assigned. And what was so fun about it too is that like everybody got so invested in the thing that they were gonna, you know, that they were gonna present. Do you remember? And it was like, I mean, it turned into like there were PowerPoint presentations, there was like full on dance presentations.
Right, dance moves, right.
It was so just kind of beautiful and elaborate. And it just like, it, like I think that it let everybody, and even the presentations that were like just sharing information, like people found such beautiful like nuggets of information that felt personal to them or something that they felt kind of inspired and interested in. So that was amazing. And then we also had, yeah, just a brilliant group of people coming in to help us inform the world of the play. People like Samuel, who teaches up at Stanford, who just gave us so much, not only like history of Ghana, but also like a linguistic history, a history of the schools, history of the names, that just kind of informed every single moment of the play. And then to have the woman who came in toward the end, her name is escaping me right now. Do you remember her name?
Oh,
it's gonna come back to me. It was like Hilda or something.
Yeah, it was something like that. Yeah.
Yes, and she came in, and she had gone to a boarding school in Ghana, and then also was just kind of giving us like the great details about, you know, how cruel some of the girls were and how funny some of the girls were, you know, when she was in school. So, you know, it's like we hope that it all seeped into what the actors were doing, but it was a lot of fun. It was like being in school. It was great.
Definitely. I remember, I think it was Hilda or something, that she said that she had to pay for her name at school. When I heard that, I was like, wow, that's next level.
That's real.
Yeah.
Bullying. Yes.
Pay her, I guess, sort of like a school mother, but it's sort of like a big sis, right? And she had to pay her big sister to use her own name. So
yes, but someone had that name already, and so right. It's like you got to pay for it. It was wild. Yeah. But it was fun. It was like, I don't know, I felt like every day we were learning something new, you know. I don't know, how did it feel for you?
Definitely. It felt like we were learning something new every day, so much every day, actually. And I think that really speaks to something you said actually the first day of rehearsal, which is, it was about curiosity and how like the human brain cannot hold both judgment and curiosity at the same time.
Yeah.
I think that's big. Yeah. And so we were just kept, I think, you know, through your direction, just kept being curious about the world, about the character, about what it was saying, and what we were trying to say, too. Actually, on that note, what questions were you sort of interrogating when, you know, directing this play for both, I guess, yourself and the actors?
Mm-hmm. Gosh, there's so many. It almost feels like there's like questions in almost like every department of the play. Like there's questions on the script, there's questions on the actors, there's questions on the design element. I feel like you know, one of the things that was really interesting is kind of learning how the comedy of the play works, you know, which is so interesting. I think it's so interesting kind of where we got to in our process, because the kind of final piece of our process that we never actually got to explore is what the relationship is between the play and the audience, you know? And I think that was a section of our process that I was really, really excited to kind of delve into and see what is that conversation between the production that we've created and the people who are gonna come and see it. But I feel like it was, you know, the play itself is asking questions about like obviously larger questions about colorism. And I think one of the questions we were also exploring is like what the nature of that colorism is, how far back does it go? And I think that as we were doing our research, and certainly in the research that we had done prior to starting rehearsal, it was just an investigation into like the roots of bias and racism and oppression, and how that can continue to manifest itself all the way through to like present generations. But looking at the evolution of something like that was so fascinating, even though the play itself is not like a historical reflection on like the history of racism. It's just like you're watching a manifestation of something in the present moment. So I think that was really interesting. But also I feel like what's so beautiful about the play is that there's so much, there's a lot of love in the play also. And the play is also exploring like, what does friendship mean? And what does it mean to find your own voice? And what does it mean to figure out what your place is in the world? And how, what is it to figure out like who you want to be in the world? And I feel like those were all questions that we were looking at every single day. And we're having to make choices inside of each of the individual moments. Like, what is it that this person wants or needs from this moment? And how is that affecting the way that they're behaving? So it's just really beautiful to just explore like all the, you know, nuances of of human and complexities of human nature, and what it means for people to dream in a way too, you know? So yeah, it was a fascinating exploration every day.
Yeah, most definitely. And I remember, this one exercise that you had the cast do, which was trying to find mm-hmm. the main idea of the play. And so we had this really large whiteboard and like everyone was popcorning, brainstorming what they thought, different words or phrases that had to do with the main idea. And then the process of like narrowing those down and distilling that into mm-hmm. one sentence. After like maybe 2 hours of conversation, I don't know, you know? It was deep, you know? Yeah. And I think what we sort of came up with, I'll just share this with everyone, is Black girls and women in search of their place in the shadows of colorism, globalization, and colonialism. So mm-hmm. just wanna, yeah, just call that into this, bring that into the space as a collective idea of what this play, you know, is about too.
Yeah.
Well, on that actually, how do you see this play, if you do, I don't know, as changing or expanding the sort of conversations we have around colorism? Like, do you feel like it, I guess, yeah.
You know, I think that one of the beautiful things I think about plays in general, but this play particularly, because Jocelyn was so smart to kind of tackle a subject, but never mention that subject by name, you know? And so really what you're doing is just watching people trying to accomplish whatever their goal is, you know? And so I think that the beautiful thing about the play is that it's just opening up a question about empathy in a way, you know? And what does it mean for us to understand the nature of colorism by really just understanding where are the places that some people get advantages, and then where are the places that other people are disenfranchised? Where are the people that some people are getting opportunities and who are getting support and are getting lifted up? And where are the places that people understanding that there is colorism at play, that there is a racism at play, have to coordinate and kind of configure their own lives in order to strive even harder, or have to take really drastic steps in order to negate the kind of corrupt systems that are at play, you know? And so I think it's just a beautiful entry into the catalog of conversation, you know what I mean? And I think that for people who have experienced colorism, we can see our own kind of lives and reflection and histories and reflections seen up on stage. And for people who have not experienced it or who want to say that it doesn't exist, they can see how it's at play inside of a very kind of pedestrian, quotidian encounters that these girls have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
I want us to talk a little bit actually about the music in the show, mm-hmm. which is amazing. Yeah. And can you tell us a little bit about the musical influences for the show? I mean, you know, Jake is incredible. Also, Jocelyn gave us some amazing just like information on how music relates to the play. But yeah, can you tell us a little bit about that process?
You know what's so fun is like, I feel like music is such a great marker of time. And so it was really, really fun to go back and listen to all this music from the 1980s. I mean, it was, Bobby Brown, Whitney right. Houston.
Seeing Bobby Brown, like from their eyes, like back in the day, like, yes, you know? Exactly.
The memory of Bobby Brown.
Right.
Bobby Brown. No, it was so much fun. And as you say, you know, Jocelyn herself has kind of articulated what some of those kind of musical markers are to help us understand where we are in time. And also just to like celebrate that music, you know, the fact that we get to just sing The Greatest Love of All in the middle of a play is amazing. But then also, and as you mentioned, we had just a brilliant sound designer, Jake Rodriguez. And the really beautiful thing that we wanted to capture is the kind of how global the music of Ghana is, you know? So we were playing a lot of 80s American pop music, which was also a global pop music, but then also infusing kind of more traditional West African music, such as High Life, and finding the places where sometimes those two sounds can bridge together. So, and sometimes in the transition, in the transitions in the play, we would kind of start off with a kind of more West African rhythm, and then it would morph into an American sound. And the kind of collision of those two sounds feels like just very just honest and real in terms of the kinds of music and the kinds of access that these girls would have had to the music.
Definitely. Yeah, no, that's so interesting. And I'm curious, is there a musical journey in the show, if you will? Like, does the music change throughout the show, in your opinion?
So the really interesting thing is, so the way that the play is set up and into each of the different scenes, in a way, if the kind of arc of the show is like that Jocelyn has created, the thing that we were using the music to do is between like the beginning and point A, you know, to get from point A to point B, we have to create an emotional bridge in a way to what the next scene is gonna be. So sometimes that meant leaving a scene, capturing the emotion of a scene, and then inside of the transition, morphing it to help us launch into whatever the next moment is. So in a way, the transitional parts of the music were these kind of emotional bridges between the different scenes. And sometimes very oftentimes it couldn't just be one type of sound. It needed to both complete something and start something else anew. But the journey of it was all about taking us on that full emotional ride.
Mm, that's so interesting. I'm thinking of those moments too, and like how different emotionally, like mm-hmm. the end of an act and the beginning of another act are, and just bridging that. That's really interesting.
Exactly. And the thing that's so brilliant, Jake, is that he was able to do that seamlessly. You almost can't tell that it's happening because he makes it sound like it's all part of one piece, so that it's not like it's a scene and a transition and a scene and transition. It's all part of one emotional journey, but the way that it's constructed is seamless, hopefully.
Yeah, definitely. Great. So you went to boarding school in Togo. And so curious, has, you know, did that influence or are any of your own boarding school experiences in the play at all? Did they seep in at all?
Yeah, they definitely did. We thankfully, and I hope I haven't just like deleted it from my memory. I don't remember us having like bullies like in the way that we have kind of bullies in schoolgirls. But you know, I think a one kind of clear example is even just scenically, right? So the cafeteria at my boarding school was on the second floor of the building. So, and it was really open in the back. So there weren't any windows. It was just open. So when we were doing the scenic design with Jason, Artisan West, our brilliant scenic designer, we knew that we wanted to create something that felt really open. And so we even looked at pictures of my boarding school because to see kind of what the expanse was. And then as we were looking at all the pictures of Ebri, because it's stunningly beautiful. It's a gorgeous town. We were like, how do we capture the nature part of this universe, you know, and just the openness and the breath and the sky. And those are certainly all things that I remember from my own boarding school. And I also remember like wearing your uniform and hand washing, you know, clothes and, you know what I mean? And sleeping in bunk beds and, but also the ways that when people are spend so much time with one another, like, you know, you go back and you're in the dorm or in the house together, like you really form such strong connections with people. And it's like, it really becomes a family of people with all the ups and downs that family that family has. And so I feel like there was a few things in the play that I was like, oh, I don't get what this relationship between these people are. It felt very familiar not with quite so much kind of cultural competition. By that I mean there's an academic competition to be sure, but the cultural competition was not as severe in my high school, thankfully.
Yeah. That's great. I was move us to something a little bit different. I was interviewing Mark Saab for the Berkeley Rep podcast for the core episode for Schoolgirls, and he's the senior director of engagement and innovation at the Museum of the African Diaspora. And we were talking about their recent exhibit, Black is Beautiful, which features the photography of Kwame Brathwaite. And so we sort of got on the topic of how photography in general can really capture a moment in time, and how Kwame in particular was just brilliant at doing this for, you know, say a concert or a protest or fashion show, really just distilling that whole event into one moment. And so I'm curious for you, is there a moment in the play that you feel sort of distills what the play is about, or like is the essence for you of the play?
I actually feel like, and I got to give a shout out to the marketing department, because I feel like there's an image that they've been using in the publicity that I think maybe because that is resonant in my mind right now, that really captures what the play is, meaning it's the image from the end of the play when the girls are sitting in front of the television, right? And the thing that strikes me about that moment and about that scene is, A, it's the girls having to kind of come together. I mean, through thick and through thin, they've been at war with one another. And you can see it in just the way that their bodies are interacting with one another. There's like friendship and camaraderie, but there's also distance between Paulina and the rest of the girls are kind of like a rigidity versus their kind of like openness and readiness. But the other thing about it is that it's the fact that they are all watching the television, watching this Western kind of program that is talking to them about what beauty is. And I think it's just such a beautiful example of what it means to take in images, to just to be consuming things, and what are the things that we're able to edit, and what are the things that we take at face value, you know? And I think that it feels like such an iconic moment in the play. And there's also headmistress kind of looming and protecting and standing over the girls through thick and through thin. But I think it's such a perfect kind of reflection of the play. It's 7 o'clock here. And so everybody outside is cheering for the first responders, as they do every night here at 7 p.m.
I didn't know that was happening.
It's so gorgeous. Every night at 7 o'clock, it's giving me goosebumps. Every night at 7 o'clock, people go out on their balconies or from their windows, and they just start cheering spontaneously for the first responders. And it's happening in places all around the city. And it makes me so sad that my apartment is at the back of the building. So I can't quite participate, but it's pretty magical to listen to every night. So.
Incredible. I'm not actually hearing it, but it's going on, I believe.
Yeah,
it's,
my apartment's in the back of the building, and I can hear people from the front of the building. It's amazing. Okay, you asked me a question. It was about capturing a moment.
You're amazing about answering it. But you were talking about sort of the end of the play and how that moment is captures both, I think, the sisterhood and the family that the girls have, and then also, you know, but also through thick and thin, sort of, you know.
Yeah. And I think it's also an interesting reflection of our current moment and how we're consuming things, what we're consuming, and our need to have an ability to kind of filter between what is useful about the imagery that we're seeing and what is not useful about the imagery that we're seeing. You know, it's like we're watching press conferences like all day around here, and it's like we have to be everybody is trying to figure out what is their level of consumption going to be for the moment, and how much do you take at face value, and you know what I mean? It's very complicated, because it's not like the beauty pageants themselves were detrimental, but what is the thing that they're saying about who can succeed in the world? And it's like very hard, especially when you're young, to be able to negotiate what's good and what's not inside of the images that you're seeing.
Yeah. I remember Jocelyn, when she had her conversation over Skype or something with the rehearsal room, speaking to that end moment. And I think the way that she sort of expressed what that meant for her sort of shifted a lot of our interpretation of that end, because it is so heartbreaking. And you see the sort of devastation of the girls looking at these images of what is beautiful on the screen and not seeing themselves reflected. And then hearing that sort of voiceover of the top 10 most beautiful women in the world, and them looking at the TV, but then us as the audience looking at them, and sort of having that be another interpretation of we are seeing the most beautiful women in the world, right? Mm-hmm. And that the sort of dual meaning in that ending as being both heartbreaking and also hopeful in some ways.
I think that's right. And you know, it's like at the end of the day, it's like what are the things that strip our kind of power away from us, or that have been created to strip our power away from us, right? Because you know, ultimately, like those women on that stage and those girls who they're representing, the multitudes of girls all around the world, particularly Black women, and particularly darker skinned Black women, but Black women in general, it's like everybody has and this kind of innate beauty. And what are the things that try to say that who you are is not beautiful?
Yeah, definitely. You broke up, you're breaking up slightly.
Do you to combat that kind of negation of our kind of great, you know, of our kind of like greatness and power. And so what is really beautiful about watching those extraordinary actors on stage, you're just like, oh my gosh, this is a phenomenal group of actors and who get to play with such a kind of a range and such complexity. So it's like, definitely a great celebration of Blackness at the same time.
Definitely. I think we're basically at time here.
Okay.
So I just want to say thank you so much for being here today with us and for sharing your insights and sort of what the process was like. And I mean, it's just a totally beautiful show. And so thank you so much for your brilliance in creating it.
Yeah, thank you so much for making the time for this and for all your amazing contributions to the process. We really couldn't have done it without you. So deep, deep, deep thanks.
Awoye. All right. Well, everyone, see you at the theater at some point. And thanks so much for tuning in.
Bye.
Bye. All right.